Yeah, so I think we can start now. Maybe let us start from the beginning. So in the last lecture, we studied about the positive and negative skew, and also we talked something about the jitter also, right? So clock skew and clock jitter. So that is what we talked about in the last lecture, and we saw that both these clock skew and clock jitter have negative effect on the performance of the circuit. And then we tried to find out how this clock skew affects the performance of the circuit. In fact, when we considered first positive clock skew, and in the positive clock skew, we saw that the total time period, right? So the period required for, or maybe the clock period required for a circuit to function correctly, so that actually reduces, right? So then we also said that why not, increase this clock skew, because clock skew is positive, so the delay or the clock period, so that can be reduced if the clock skew is positive. But then we said that you cannot increase this clock skew beyond a certain limit, because if you increase it beyond a certain limit, then there would be race conditions in this circuit. Now, then we also talked about the hold time requirements of the same circuit, and we commented that the delay of this combinational logic block plus the delay of this register, so that should be greater than hold time plus the total skew, right? So otherwise, if you don't have this condition is not fulfilled, then the data may be sampled at this point itself, edge number 2, and we want to sample the data at edge number 4. We don't want to sample the data at edge number 2 by register number 2 here, right? So to overcome that, we said that there must be a requirement on this hold time. So that requirement is this, that is total delay of the combinational logic block plus clock to queue delay of this register 1. So that should be greater than hold time plus total skew. Then we also commented on the negative skew. So negative skew when the clock edge 2 here, so this arrives early than clock 1, right? Earlier than clock 1 if clock edge 2 arrives. And then in this case, we found that the total clock period required for this circuit to function correctly in presence of negative skew, so this period goes down, right? That is, system becomes faster. And also, if we look at the hold time condition, so then we find that the hold time condition, so this changes to this, and when delta is negative, that is clock skew is negative, we commented that this system will never fail because this requirement is always fulfilled. When delta is negative, that is skew is negative, this requirement is always fulfilled in a negative clock skew system. So we said that why not utilize this negative clock skew to build systems, because it will be a good system as it will never fail, right? But then we also commented that there could be race conditions also, and the performance of the system may also go down if you have this kind of negative skew in the system. And also, it is not also always possible to ensure in a circuit that there will only exist negative skew, because in a real world scenario, for example, like this, so this is from a data path of some microprocessor. Let us say a data path look like this. So it is more complex, but yes, it has feedback loops and synchronous kind of system it has. So in this system, you will always find that data moves in both the direction, not just one direction. So in the positive skew, we discussed that both data and clock move in the same direction. And then in the negative skew situations, the data and clock, they move in the opposite direction. So you cannot ensure a system which has only negative skew, because in the systems with feedback, in fact, all systems, all sequential systems are made by having a feedback from the output to the input. So when there is a feedback, so obviously that means the data is also moving in opposite direction, right? So it was earlier moving in this direction, but now because of this feedback, it also moves in the reverse direction. So you can never ensure, one can never ensure that only negative skew will exist in a system. So both positive and negative skew can exist, right? So it is not possible to design a system which has only negative skew, right? So that's how we say that this assumption, where we said that if you have a negative skew in the system, system will never fail. So why not design all systems which have only negative skew? So this assumption is not feasible or not possible. Okay? So therefore, the designer has to look for ways to overcome this situation, that is ways to reduce the skew in the system, that is ways to reduce the positive and negative skew in the system, okay? Not to utilize these skews to build a system, okay? So that is why the clock networks, that is the networks which can route clock from one point to another, so those are essential. So in this course, we'll talk about the clock network. In fact, maybe in this class itself. Now, apart from skew, one can also find out the impact of jitter. So far we have only talked about the impact of skew on the overall clock period. But yes, one can also extend the same analysis to find out the impact of jitter on the overall clock frequency or clock period. So for example, this clock, okay, so this is applied to this system. Again, it's a sequential synchronous system. So this clock is applied, and let us say that this clock has jitter. Okay, so that is the clock is, actually the clock is starting from edge number 2 and it is ending at edge number 5. So this is my actual clock. At edge number 2, it starts, originates and ends at edge number 5. And then at edge number 5 itself, the next clock cycle starts. Okay? So the total clock period is T clock, okay, the original one. Now let us say because of jitter, the clock starts early at edge number 1 here. Okay? So instead of starting at edge number 2, it starts early at edge number 1. Okay? And it ends also early at edge number 4 here, instead of ending at edge number 5. Okay? Or maybe the clock can start at edge number 3 and end at edge number 6. Okay? So that is, clock is starting late and ending also late. So these situations are possible because of jitter. Okay? Now, to find out the impact of jitter, one has to find out the worst case scenario. Okay? So worst case scenario has to be found to find out the impact of jitter on the performance of this circuit, right? So to find out the worst case scenario, let us once again look at this clock signal, okay? And let us say that the clock starts late at edge number 3 here, okay? To find out the worst case scenario, let us say that the clock starts late at edge number 3 here, okay, here, and it also ends, sorry, it ends early at edge number 4 here. Okay? So it starts late at edge number 3 and it ends early at edge number 4, right? So the total clock period now, so that is reduced. Okay? So now I have only this much clock period left. Okay? That is, total clock period now is T clock minus 2T jitter, right? 2T jitter. The total clock period now in this case is T clock minus 2T jitter. So this is my worst case scenario, okay? Because here the total clock period has reduced. Okay? Now the effect of this reduction in clock period can be seen from here. So the reduction in clock period means now my circuit, that is these two elements, so they have to finish the processing of data within only this much time period. So earlier T clock was the period that was allowed for them to process the data, but now they have to finish executing or processing the data in a reduced period. Okay? And imagine if the delay of this combinational logic block plus register is greater than this time, that is the reduced clock period time. So then obviously this circuit will not function correctly, right? So this is actually the effect of the jitter. Okay, so the worst case scenario, from the worst case scenario, one can find out the effect of the jitter on the performance of the circuit, right? So we will again extend the same analysis that we did for a positive or negative clock skew system. That is, we'll try to find out the clock period, the total minimum clock period required for this circuit to work correctly, right, via this equation, right? So the same analysis is extended for this circuit in case of jitter. So we try to find out the minimum clock frequency. So the minimum clock frequency required, that is now T clock minus 2T jitter is the minimum clock period. So that should be greater than equal to clock to Q delay of resistor plus logic delay of my combinational logic block plus the setup time, right? So that means my total clock period has modified. And now if I bring this 2T jitter on the right hand side, right? So this means now my total minimum clock period requirement, so that has actually increased, okay? So that means my circuit has become slower because of jitter, right? So because of jitter, minimum clock period required for this circuit to function correctly has increased by this factor 2T jitter. So this means that circuit has become slower, right? So that means my, you know, jitter in the circuit can directly affect the performance of any circuit, not just this circuit. So circuit will become slow, as in this case, and that is found from the worst case, scenario analysis. Now other scenarios can also be examined in the same way. Now so far we have discussed both skew and jitter individually. Now in a real world scenario, both skew and jitter, so they can exist at the same time. So I hope my voice is audible to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Right. So in the real world scenario, yes, in the real world scenario, you can have both skew and jitter present at the same time, right? So that means one has to find out the impact of, you know, both these quantities, which are present at the same time. Yeah. So that means similar analysis, again, one has to find out now the effect of them, that is skew and jitter, on minimum clock period requirement. Now again, assume the same circuit which we have used earlier, that is on the positive edge of this clock one, this resistor one samples the data, and then on the other positive edge, that is clock two, when becomes positive here, that is at this point, the data is sampled by resistor number two, right? So resistor number one samples the data at edge number two here, and resistor two should sample a data at edge number, this is 11, right? So clock one, so this actually is from edge number two, okay? So the actual clock one is from edge number two to edge number eight, right? So that is my actual clock one, right? So which has a period of T clock. Similarly, clock two here, so that originates from edge number five, okay? That is at this point, and ends at edge number 11, that is at this point. Here, right? So again, the total period is T clock, right? Now because of skew, my clock 2 is delayed by delta, right? So this is delta here, that is from edge number 2 to 5, right? 2 to 5, that is here, 2 to 5. So this is my skew, right, which is mentioned over here, right? So clock 2 is delayed by delta, that is I have a clock skew in my system, okay? Now also assume that clock one and clock two, they also have jitters, right? So that is temporal variations now are seen in clock one, that is clock one can be seen at one also and three also. I mean, it can start early at one, or maybe it can start early late at three, right? Similarly, it can start end early at seven and end late at nine, right? So instead of ending at 8, it ends at 7 or 9, that is early or late. Similarly, clock 2, it had to start here at edge number 5, but it can start early at 4 or it can start late at 6. Okay. Similarly, it had to end at 11, edge number 11 here, but it can, you know, end early at 10 and it can also end late at 12, right? So now one has to also again find the worst case scenario here. So now worst case scenario can be found by again looking at these two clocks, and it can be found that the worst case scenario happens when the leading edge of the current clock period, clock one, right? So this is my clock one here, which is the current clock period, let us say, right? So the leading edge of the clock one happens late at edge number three, that is, it starts late here. Leading edge of clock one starts late at edge number three here, okay? And the leading edge of the next cycle, clock two, this happens early at edge number 10, that is this point, right? So because at clock two, that is when the clock two makes a positive transition, that is at 11 edge number 11, register two should sample a data. So that is why I say leading edge of clock two starts early, right? So which starts here at point number 10, right? So it starts at 3 and 10, right? So 3 is clock one and 10 for clock two, right? So this is my worst case scenario, that is leading edge of clock one, it starts late at edge number 3, and the leading edge of clock two, it ends early, that is at edge number 10. We'll write it ends early. Okay, we'll write here it, this one starts late and this one ends early. So this is my worst case scenario, right? So this is my worst case scenario. Okay. Worst case. Okay, so for this worst case scenario, again one can find out the same minimum clock period requirement. Okay. So minimum clock period requirement can be now found by using the same previous old equation, and this time the minimum clock period would be in the case of positive skew, if I go back here, in the case of positive skew, that is this one here, this one. So we had t plus delta, right? And delta is positive here, right? So same will apply to this case. So this becomes t clock plus delta, and delta is positive here, minus t jitter 1 minus t jitter 2, right? So t clock plus, because my clock period now has reduced, okay, by this much amount, that is t clock plus delta minus t jitter 1 minus t jitter 2. So this is t jitter 1 because it is starting late, and this is t jitter 2 because it is ending early, sorry, it is starting early, clock 2, right? So the total clock period requirement is now only this much. I mean, it starts from here, okay, and it ends at edge number 10, that is this much. So this is my total clock period requirement, right? From here to here, this point to, not this point, this point, 10. Sorry, this one, this point, 10, here. This is edge number 10. So this is my minimum clock period now, which is equal to t clock plus skew minus t jitter 1 minus t jitter 2. And this should be greater than or equal to clock to q delay of register plus the combinational logic block delay plus setup time. Okay. Now if you bring this t jitter 1 and t jitter to the right hand side and also skew, so you will find that total clock period requirement. Okay. So now that has increased by, this much time. Okay. Right. So this is how one can find out the effect of the clock skew and jitter on not just this circuit, but any circuit. Now one can also find out the hold time requirement for this circuit. So hold time requirement can be found. So for hold time requirement, we understand that the delay of this register plus delay of this combinational logic block, so that has to be greater than the clock skew plus the hold time, and now plus jitter also, that will also be included now, right? So the hold time requirement is now, that is my delay of the combinational logic block plus the delay of the register one. So that should be greater than skew plus hold time plus 2 times jitter. If jitter 1 and jitter 2 are equal, so one can say should be greater than 2 times 2 jitter, right? Now this relation, I mean, if you bring this T hold and T jitter on the RHS, then you will find the constraint on skew time or skew. So this indicates that total acceptable skew, right? That is total acceptable skew. So this is reduced by the jitter of the two signals, or 2 times the jitter, it has reduced. So earlier, without jitter, we had total skew time. So that was only up to this much, yeah? That is this much only, without jitter. Okay. Now with jitter, this skew time, that is total acceptable skew, so that has further reduced by 2 times 2 jitters. That means you should not have more than this much skew in the circuit for the circuit to function correctly, right? So earlier, if you go back, you will find in the case when we had, yeah, here this case, right? So in this case, the requirement was that skew is only up this much, right? But now you have a requirement that T jitter 1 plus 2, or maybe 2 T jitter will also come. Okay, that is, my skew requirement has gone more complex now. That is, I cannot have skew more than this in the circuit to work correctly. Yeah. So that was assuming the case when skew was positive, right? So previous analysis was for the case when we had a positive skew in the system, right? Now, similarly, one can also find out the constraints on the clock period and hold time when negative skew is present in the circuit, right? So for negative skew, you will draw a clock 2, which arrives earlier than clock 1, okay? And then you will also put delta, that is skew is less than 0, okay? So maybe you can simply put delta as negative over here in this equation, and this equation will modify, right, to capture the effect of negative skew in the system, right? Similarly, for finding on the clock period, you will simply modify the, again, put delta as negative here. So delta will go here, it will become positive, right? So the total clock period will become further more than this much. That is, total clock period requirement will go up in the case of negative skew in the system plus jitter, or the system will become more slower, right? So that can be found again from here itself, right? Now, to overcome these issues, that is, one has to always think about minimizing, how to minimize the clock skew in the system. So that should be the goal of the designer. So for minimizing the clock skew, one can think of using a clock distribution network, right? So for example, this H-tree clock distribution network, which looks like this. So this can be utilized to route the clock. Okay? So this looks like a H over here, right? So that's why the name is H-tree. Now, how the clock is distributed here? So at the center, at this point, the clock is routed, right? So main clock signal is attached to the center of the H-tree. And from here, the clock signal can be routed to maybe this point or maybe this point, right? So this is, if only to these two points the clock signal is routed, so this is called level 1 H-tree clock network. Okay. So you will find that the delay, that is, so the clock, there will be no clock uncertainty, that is, clock skew is negligible here. So because the RC delay, right, so this is RC delay, so which is matched for both the paths, that is this path and this path, they are equal in length. Right, so length is equal, path length is equal, length of paths is equal. Okay. So if length of path is equal, so it is assumed that RC delay will also be equal. Okay. So RC delay of 1 would be equal to RC delay of 2. Okay. So that is how the delay is matched. So no skew. If I have to write route a data at this point also, and clock at this point also. Similarly, if I want to route the same clock signal to maybe this point, this point, this point, okay, this point, and also this point, then this point, and this point. So all these 8 points, yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So all these 8 points, the data can be routed or the clock can be routed without any delay or without any skew, right? Because again, we are using the same concept, that is length of paths are equal from source to destination, right? So this is my source and all these red dots are destination. So the length of paths are equal from source to destination, so that RC delays are also equal for each path, right? So from here it will go, and then maybe you can go here or maybe here it can go, right? So all these paths are equal. So I don't have any delay, I don't have any clock skew, right? So similarly, one can route here, here, right? All these, dark shaded square blocks. So here also the data can be, or clock can be routed without any delay. Because the idea is to equalize the length of paths from source to destination, so that the RC delays are also matching or equal. Okay. So that is actually the idea of the clock tree distribution networks like H tree. Then there are many more clock tree distribution networks. Okay. Now, in the clock distribution networks, we have already seen what is clock gating. So clock gating is, you want to save clock power dissipation, or you don't want more clock power dissipation. So you will cut the clock supply in the portions of chip where the clock is not required, or the portions of my clock network or the chip where the components are sitting idle, right? So if the components are sitting idle, so you can think of cutting the clock power supply or clock supply to those portions, or even to this network itself. Okay, so let's say if this half is not working, it is idle, so I can cut the clock supply to this part of my clock network, right? So this is called clock gating. Okay. Now, similar to clock gating, there is another term called clock conditioning. Okay. So now this is also similar to clock gating. Clock conditioning is ability of this clock network to cut the clock supply to any portion of this network, right? So both are almost similar. Now this, as I said, H tree distribution network, this works on balanced path trees, that is length of paths are equal. So that is why we say that RC delay, so those are also equal. So there is no skew or no delay. I mean, all the delays are same. So no skew exists. In fact, in real world scenario, you will see that a H tree distribution network may look like this. So it's a more realistic H tree, right? So maybe I think it starts at this point, okay? And then the data, this is level one, and then this is level two, right? Here, and then again, you have more levels coming from here. So many levels could be there in a H3 clock distribution network. Now, apart from clock distribution network, there is another technique which can be used to route the clock. That is called grid or grid system. So here the clocks are available on all four sides of the chip, right? So I have a chip over here, right? So this is my chip, let us say, and on the chip, on all the four sides, I have my clock signals, right? So clock signals or clock generators are present, and then via some driver I can route the clock signal through this grid. Yeah, so this mesh of interconnect, so this is called actually grid, right? So it's a dense network of interconnects, right, or wires, which is called grid. So via these grids, the clock can be routed to any point, okay? Maybe at this point, or maybe at this point, or maybe at this point, right? To any point, the clock can be routed via these wires or a network of wires, which is called a grid. Okay. Now in this grid type of clock distribution system, you will find that delay from the final driver to each load, so that is not matched. right? So delay from the final driver, that is this driver, to the load, maybe this load or this load. So that is not matched. So you can, that means, you know, route the clock maybe from here to here to this component. And if I want to route to this component, I can route this way, right? So the delay is not matched. Okay. Now, this is the fundamental difference between the H tree and the grid system of distributing clock, clock, right? But yes, it has some usefulness. That is, it allows late design changes to your circuit, okay? Because the clock is easily accessible on the die, right? So clock is present everywhere. It is easily accessible through these grids. So one can think of allowing or using late design changes. Okay. Now, a disadvantage of this kind of system would be that because of this unnecessary extra interconnects or wires, power dissipation of this clock distribution network will be very large. Okay. Or it results into an unnecessary or large power dissipation because of extra unnecessary interconnects or wires, which may even not be utilized. Now, an example where this grid system is used. So it is used in this DEC Alpha 21164 microprocessor, where the clock frequency is somewhere around 300 megahertz and it has 9.3 million transistors. Clock load is of somewhere around 3.7 nanofarads. Then power in clock distribution network. So this is important to notice that the clock distribution network itself takes almost half of the total power. Total power dissipation is 50 of this microprocessor. But the interconnects, that is clock distribution network, so that takes somewhere around 20 watts of power out of this 50 watt total power dissipation of this microprocessor. Right. Now, yeah, so the layout can give you a real feeling of how complex things are. So this portion of the layout, so this represents the location or position of the clock drivers in this microprocessor. Okay, so entire this range, you have clock drivers sitting. Though in this picture, it seems that clock drivers are available everywhere on all these four edges, but yes, they can further be optimized and you can have clock drivers only at, two specific locations, which is actually in this layout of this microprocessor.